You know, the scripture teaches us that perilous times will come. In the end days, the scripture teaches us that it will be perilous times. Fearful times. Times that might scare you half to death. Times where you're going to see things and you think, man, I've never seen nothing like that before in my life. And then you pay closer attention to it. The things that you ain't never seen before in your life just seem to get worse. We're noticing things in our world news today. I'm going to be honest with you. When I was a kid growing up, I never thought I'd hear tell of some of the things that's going on today. I think the church has gotten off course a little bit. It's not the church's fault that things are going on, what's going on. It's the world we live in. Sin is run rampant. Nobody wants any rules anymore. Nobody wants to be told this is what we do and this is how we do it. Pride speaks. I say, well, I'm going to do what I want to do. Some folks will even use the Bible to justify their prideful action. I'm just following what I believe the Lord would have me to do. Well, listen, if what you believe the Lord would have you to do doesn't match up with what's written in the Bible, then you're not following the Lord, you're following yourself. It's going to be perilous times. Certainly perilous times too. Said it would be a time when men would not endure sound doctrine. What is sound doctrine? Can any of y'all define for me? And there's no right or wrong. I just want to get somebody's point of view. What does sound doctrine mean? Anybody got an answer for that? What the Bible says. There you go. Amen. It's sound. It's solid. God spoke it. Holy men of old, moved by the Holy Spirit, wrote it down, left it behind for our learning. If it's in here, it's sound, it's solid, it won't fail you.
The balanced Word of God. And when I say that, sound means complete and true.
Complete and true. Amen. So the whole doctrine of God. We can't, you know, there are some churches that just focus on the New Testament, part of the Bible. They'll say that the Old Testament was for the Hebrews, and it's not for a New Testament church today. And we have respect for the Old Testament, but we are going to preach only the New Testament. Well, you're missing out on an awful lot because the Old Testament is a picture of the New Testament, and when you put those two together, it forms the whole doctrine of God. And then we get sound doctrine. Amen. But said they would rather heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. They want to hear what they want to hear. If they don't want to hear it, then don't you preach it or teach it. So I think the church world has gotten off course a little bit. We're focusing on, I don't want to say this, focusing on things that need our prayers and they need our attention. But the everlasting gospel of Jesus Christ does not change. Do you know in the book of Revelation there is an angel flying to and fro in the heavens declaring the everlasting gospel of Jesus Christ? Everlasting means everlasting.
Yeah.
Means it doesn't end. It doesn't change. It won't go away. It's not going to fade. You can't water it down. You can't candy coat it. It is what it is. It's the gospel of Jesus Christ. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And that love caused Jesus Christ to leave His home in glory, to come here, to bleed and die, that we might attain salvation. That's the gospel. It doesn't just stop there. He didn't just die on an old rugged cross. If you're looking for Jesus Christ to be hanging on a cross, you're looking for the wrong thing. They took Him down off the cross. They buried Him in a borrowed tomb. If you're looking for Jesus Christ in the tomb, you're looking for the wrong thing. He's no longer in the tomb because all Jesus Christ to be walking here on this earth in a risen form, you're looking for the wrong thing. Because the scripture says that he ascended back up into heaven on a cloud of glory, where he is seated at the right hand of the Father, making intercessions for the saints. I love it when I know you all are praying for me. And I know that you love it when you know that I'm praying for you. That's making intercession. That's intercessory prayer. You interceding on my behalf. Me interceding on your behalf. It's a blessing, isn't it? To know that we're praying for one another.
Yes.
Oh! Jesus Christ is seated at the right hand of the Father making intercession for us.
Yes.
On a daily basis, he said, "Hey, Father, that one's mine." "Hey, Father, that one's got a heart broken. Hey, Father, that one is suffering from fear of a sickness. Hey, Father, that one's going to have surgery." He's making intercession for us. It blesses me to know you're praying for me, but I'm going to be honest with you. I'm more excited knowing that Jesus is praying for me. But if your gospel stops with him seated at the right hand of the Father, you've been taught wrong. Because the full gospel of Jesus Christ is that he came, that he bled and died for our sin, that he was buried and resurrected on the third and appointed day. The full gospel is that he resurrected back up into heaven, where he's making intercessions for you and for me. And the full gospel includes the fact that one day he is coming back again in like manner to take his church home and to set things right upon this earth. That's the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's what we're to be focused upon. Some of the old folks say, "This ain't church anymore." I've heard them say that. Some of the folks, and when I say old folks, I'm not just talking about 80-year-olds, 70-year-olds, 60-year-olds, or 50-year-olds. You can be in your 20s and have been walking with the Lord Jesus Christ since you were 10. You're an old folk in Jesus Christ. You're older than some. And we can remember back at a time when things ain't quite like they are today.
Yeah.
Now, there's those who have just recently come to know Jesus Christ, the current church world that we are living in and worshiping in. This is all they know. So when they hear us talk about the old paths, when they hear us talk about the old foundation, when they hear us talk about those things, they don't know. I preached a message last Sunday evening in Gilead that is still hanging with me today. So I want you to open your Bibles with me, if you will, to the book of Ezra, chapter number 3. Ezra, chapter number 3. As you're turning in your Bibles to the book of Ezra, chapter number 3, you know, I testified to you a couple weeks ago that when I was at home sick for 3 weeks, the devil tried to discourage me, but praise the name of Jesus, I took that time to do a lot of praying and a lot of studying. I figured if I'm going to be laying in this bed sick, I may as well pick up the Bible and read the Word of God and seek the Lord in prayer. And even in a sick bed, the Lord gave me victory. Amen. Because I was in the presence of the Holy Spirit. So I'm going to tell you, I spent an awful lot of time praying. I spent an awful lot of time reading. But I also spent some time, I'm just going to be honest with you, I also spent some time watching TV. And you know how boring daytime television is? Hey, nighttime television to me is boring, but daytime television is the worst. They fill up a time slot with more useless things than you can shake a stick at. So I'm channel surfing. How many of you know what it is to channel surf? I've gotten pretty good at it. I know how to use the forward button, I know how to use the last button just in case I forgot what the channel was. And I found this, I wish I would have wrote it down because I don't even know where it's at now, and I would love to go back to it. I found this station, and it's all old. I watched The Rifleman. How many of you know what The Rifleman is?
Yeah.
Okay. I watched episodes of The Rifleman. And I remember when I was a kid, I used to think, man, when I grow up, I want to be here. When I got my Daisy Red Ryder gun, how many of you know what a Daisy Red Ryder is? Okay, good. That's still prevalent to today's age. When I got my first Daisy Red Ryder, I was The Rifleman in my backyard. You know, and I just later and I watched that and I thought, oh my goodness, I can't believe I found The Rifleman. I watched that. And you know what? When The Rifleman was over, Laverne and Shirley came on. How many of you know Laverne and Shirley? I thought, Laverne and Shirley. And when Laverne and Shirley was over, Emergency came on. You remember Emergency? How about Chips? Chips came on. And just when I'm thinking this can't get any better than this, I'm going to do something. Anybody know what that is? My Three Sons. I thought, oh my goodness, I cannot believe what I have found. I was so excited that I found this television station. Later on in the evening, I thought, you know, if daytime is so good, and I wonder what nighttime is. And it was one old movie after another. How many of you can tell me the names of the characters in Laverne and Shirley? Quick. I just gave you the answer. Laverne and Shirley. Laverne and Squiggy. How about, who is your favorite character in My Three Sons?
Uncle Charlie.
Uncle Charlie. He's mine too. Oh yeah, I saw an episode of The Munsters. How many of you remember The Munsters? There was a movie that I watched while I was off sick. How many of you are familiar with The Wizard of Oz? How many of you know the characters in The Wizard of Oz? Who's the characters?
Tin Man.
Lion. The Lion.
Scarecrow.
Dorothy. The Wicked Witch of the West.
Toto.
About The Wizard of Oz. Would you keep me as your pastor or would you make me leave?
We've heard about frogs and crickets before.
Hey, you've heard about frogs and crickets before.
We might keep you.
You'd probably keep him, okay. I want to talk to you about The Wizard of Oz today. Most importantly, I want to talk to you about how far we have drifted away and the reasons for it. Read with me. Is everybody in the book of Ezra, chapter 3? I'm going to start reading at verse 10. What you need to know is that an awful lot of time has passed between the time that the first temple was built to the destruction of the temple to the time where the temple had been rebuilt. We are stepping into the threshold of a worship service that was taking place because of the rebuilding of the temple. Verse number 10, and when the builders laid the foundation of the temple of the Lord, they set the priests in their apparel with trumpets, and the Levites, the son of Asaph, with cymbals, to praise the Lord after the ordinance of David, king of Israel. So right off of the bat, we see how that a foundation had been laid. Can I tell you there's already a foundation laid? And it's a foundation that cannot be improved upon. You can't go back with the blueprints and take a look at the design of it. There is one foundation that has been laid, and another foundation cannot ever be laid. There's only one foundation, and that foundation is the love of God through Jesus Christ our Lord. There's no other way to salvation. There's no other way to the blessings of God in your life. You're either going to go through and by Jesus Christ, or you're not going to go through. He is the foundation of the church. He shed his righteous blood so that we lost sinners might find grace and redemption through Jesus Christ. And our names might be recorded in the Lamb's Book of Life, and heaven might be our home. Outside of Jesus Christ, to quote Brother Darrell as he's quoting me, you are lost as a goose and headed for a devil's hell. You can't lay another foundation. Today, they want to lay so many different foundations. Each person has their own foundation that they want to build upon, and shame on anybody that says anything at all about their foundation. My foundation is sure. My foundation is strong. And don't you tell me any different. If your foundation does not match up with the foundation that's found written in the Word of God, then you have no foundation.
Amen.
You can take two houses. What's the scripture teaches? It gives us a picture of two builders and two houses. A wise man and a foolish man, both builders. And it tells us that the wise man will dig deep into the ground and lay a foundation and build his house. And because it was built upon foundation, when the winds blow and the rains fall and the floods beat upon that house will stand. Because it is built upon a foundation. But the foolish man who builds his house on sand and lays no foundation, when the winds blow and the rains fall and the floods ascend, it will beat upon that house and that house will fall because it's not founded. But can I tell you something? For the first 10 years maybe, you can build your house on this side of the street and I can build my house on this side of the street. You can lay a foundation over here and I can build right on the ground over here. And for the first few years, 5 years, 10 years maybe, you can drive by our houses and you'll see absolutely no difference. My house will look just as good as your house does. And I can stand in my front yard and look at you and boast, I saved money because I didn't lay no foundation. And look, my house is just as nice as yours. But after time passes, after some time has passed, my house will fall to pieces and crumble to the ground because it is not built upon anything solid. And I'll be knocking on your door saying, neighbor, can you let me in? I don't have any place to lay my head tonight because my house is just falling. Our world today thinks they do not need the foundation of the Lord, that they can get by just fine without it. And they're looking back and they're saying, look at my life. Look at my home. Look at my family. We're happy. We're healthy. We've got everything you've got. And we did it our way. Give it some time and those things will fall apart. Because the only life that will be solid and wholesome and true and pure and strong is a life that is built upon the foundation of the Lord. These people got together and they laid a foundation. And they praised with music. Do you see that? They set the priests in order in their apparel with trumpets. And the Levites, the sons of Ahab, with cymbals to praise the Lord after the ordinance of David, king of Israel. So just like we do today, they got together and there was music in the temple. There was first a foundation, and then there was music, and then there was praising. So far we're doing good, aren't we? And they sang together by chorus in praising and giving thanks. And giving thanks. And giving thanks. Well, I don't know what we got to be thankful for. Friend, go home. I've taught you this before. This ain't no new revelation. But it's something that I live by. After church today, I want you to go home and spend 30 seconds. That's all it's going to take. It won't take up your whole day. I want you to spend 30 seconds of your time. Stand closest to the nearest mirror in your house and get as close as you can and go. If you see that mirror fog up, start praising the Lord. You've got something to be thankful for.
Amen.
We don't give thanks anymore. We go to Him in prayer when we're in need.
Yeah.
Oh, Lord. I got a bad word from the doctor and I need you now. I need you to touch me. I need you to heal me. I need you now. I need you now. I need you now. How about the last 30 or 40 years that you've been living healthy? How long? How many times have you prayed vehemently to the Lord with just a word of thanks? We're really good to go to Him with our needs, but how good are we to go to Him with our thanks? Because He's good. You know the Lord's been so good to us. Hasn't He been good to us?
Yes.
Oh my goodness. He's been just so good. We take up prayer requests. Brother Darrell gets up every Sunday morning and takes up your prayer request, and it blesses me to hear. And I wrote it down today. There was almost as many praises in the church house today as there was prayer requests. Almost as many praises saying thank you God for this or thank you God or I praise the Lord for this. We had almost as many praises in the church house this morning as we had prayer requests. And I think that's an absolutely wonderful thing. We praise the Lord because He's good. You know, there's an old bluegrass song that we used to sing years ago back in the old home church. And I can't help it. This goes sound country, but it is what it is. The name of that song is He Ain't Ever Done Me Nothing But Good. Have you ever heard that song? If you have never heard that song, I'll play it for you on the radio. It's a wonderful song. He ain't ever done me nothing but good.
Yeah.
The Lord's been so good to us. When I wasn't worth loving, He loved me. When I wasn't worth calling, He called me. When I wasn't worth drawing, He drew me. Listen, the Lord didn't save a born-again gospel preacher. When He called my name, He called a lost sinner. He called someone who needed Jesus Christ in his life. He didn't come to save the righteous. He came to save the lost. And because He came to save the lost, we have been made the righteousness of God in Jesus Christ. I feel like my head's going to explode here. Before I was worth loving, He loved me.
Yes.
Before you were worth loving, He loved you.
Yes.
And He drew you by His Holy Spirit. And He wrapped His arms of love around you and said, I know you've sinned. I know you've committed. I know you've got it wrong. I know you, yet I love you.
Yeah.
And I'm willing to forgive you. And He forgave us of our sins. He forgave us of our iniquities. He filled us with His Holy Spirit. He made us new creatures in Christ Jesus. He ain't ever done me nothing but good. During the times of my life when I didn't know how I was going to buy another meal for my family, they always somehow got something to eat. It might have been pinto beans and peanut butter sandwiches, but they had something to eat, and I thanked the Lord every time for it. He's healed me when I've been sick. Oh, He's given me direction when I needed direction. He's touched you when you have needed to be touched. He ain't ever done me nothing but good. The Lord's good to us. For His mercy endureth forever. Ain't that a blessing?
Yes.
To know that you're going to wake up tomorrow and get it wrong. To know that by the end of the day today, somewhere along the line, you're going to get it wrong. But you have a God whose mercy endures forever. When we go to Him with a broken heart and a contrite spirit and say, Lord, I've gotten it wrong again. I repent of my sin. Will you forgive me? To know that His mercy kicks in because it endures forever. And the blood of Jesus Christ washes us of our sins. We stand back to our feet. The scripture teaches us that a just man will fall 7 times but rises back up. That's because of the everlasting mercy of our God.
Yes.
I love the Bible. I love His word. And all the people shouted with a great shout when they praised the Lord. This sounds like a worship service that I would want to be included in. How about you?
Yeah.
Would you want to attend that service?
Amen.
Ooh, I'd love to have been there. I would have loved to have been there because I can shout the best of it. Hey, man, I can just get all indignant. I can stomp my feet and clap my hands and holler and shout and praise. Now listen, just because you don't do that doesn't mean I'm more of a child of God than you are. Hey, man, I don't want to cast that down on anybody. You got your way of praising the Lord, and I got my way of praising the Lord. But praise the Lord, we all get it done, don't we? I don't know about you, but I would love to have been in that worship service. And all this was happening because the foundation of the house of the Lord was laid. They got excited over that. We get excited over NASCAR. I'm just going to tell you, if Casey Kane ever does cross the finish line and get a checkered flag, I am going to come out of my skin. All right? I'm looking for that day. And he always gets really, really close, but something happens, and I'm thinking, all right, what we got next week? But if he ever does get the checkered flag, Brother Darrell, you're going to hear me shouting from Rochester all the way here to Akron. I'm just going to beat that happen. We can shout over a football game or a NASCAR race. We get excited about that, guys, but we don't get excited about the things of the Lord anymore. You know what? Not too long ago, I had somebody, and I'm not going to mention any names, and yes, just know that the Lord has put in me a loving and a kind and a forgiving heart. But next time you tell me, preacher, if it can't be said in 20 minutes, it ain't worth being said, you got to know I'm going home and praying for you. We don't get excited about the things of the Lord anymore. We'll sit for hours and watch a NASCAR race, but if I preach longer than 20 minutes, somebody gets mad. That ain't right. I think we've gotten off course. Now, I want you to look at verse 12. But many of the priests and the Levites and chief of the fathers, who were, I don't know what translation of the scripture you're reading, but I'm in the King James. Who were ancient men. They'd been around a while. They were the old folks. Been walking with the Lord a long time. They were ancient men. They were ancient women. I don't think 50 years old is ancient. Unless maybe you're one of these children sitting here. And I remember when 50 years old was, oh man, that's old now. Now that I'm in my 50s, I'm thinking that ain't quite so old. When the scripture says ancient, when I say the ancient men, you ancient men, you ancient women, I'm not accusing you of being old and feeble. What this means is those who have been walking with the Lord a long time and have been in worship services and have heard the word of truth and know that God calls preachers and know the power of prayer and know what fellowship can do to your heart and to your home. Those of us who have battled storms and been delivered, walked through valleys, and made it to the other side. Those of us who have walked with the Lord, we're the ancients. But many of the priests and Levites and the chief of the fathers who were ancient men that had what? Seen. They were there. They were present. They worshipped in the old temple. They had seen the first house when the foundation of this house was laid before their eyes. What were they doing? They were weeping with a loud voice down. Now we have a contrast here. We have the undercrowd Help me, Lord Jesus. They don't know what it was to come up through what some of you and I have come up through. They don't know what it is to have battled some of the things that we have battled. They don't know what it was to have been part of the builders that laid a foundation that they were able to build upon and have a strong, healthy life. They weren't there. But they gathered together and they say, that was then and this is now. That was 19 something. That was 1975. I barely remember the 70s. Hopefully some of you do. That was in the 60s. That was in the 80s. We don't do it that way anymore. We don't want that. We want this. And they're so excited. And they say, well, look, we're in the temple. We're laying foundations. We're worshiping. We're praising. And they're happy. But the ancients are weeping. We have a contrast. We have a difference. They're gathered together in the same place at the same time. And some of them are happy. Some of them are overjoyed. Some of them are worshiping. Some of them are praising. Some of them are shouting. But the ancients are saying, shouted with a loud shout, and the noise was heard afar off. So we have a problem. Don't we have a problem in the church? What do we do with our problems? Some people say, I ain't got no problems. And they just mutter on. It's like, that's not good. So you cannot deny. Oh, you can, but you ain't ever gonna fix anything in your life as long as you deny that there's a problem. Some people will run from their problems. Can I tell you, you cannot run from your problems? Your problems are gonna find you no matter where you're at. You can lie and say, I got no problems. But you know that's not the truth. The only thing you can do with your problems is face them. Face them in faith. Face them based upon the Word of God. Following good godly counsel. And if you have to change some things, then change some things. If you have to let go of some things, then let go of some things. If you have to embrace some things and never let go, then embrace some things and never let go. But you have to face issues when they come. Or they're never going to go away. So today I want to face some things. The temple, and I wrote some of these things down so that I would not forget them, and I want to get them right. When the temple was finished, the old men that had seen the first temple wept. But the young men that had never seen the glory of God come down, they were shouting for joy. Do you know there are some people that do not know what it is to be involved in a church or even in a life? In your home. On your job, in your communities, you don't just have to be in the house of God to see the glory of God come down. Amen. You can see the glory of God come down right in your place of employment. You can see the glory of God come down right in your own home. You can see the glory of God come down. Just yesterday, we were out working in the yard. Boy, the sun was shining. It was nice. We had a couple of grandkids out. And we were out there in the yard working and had one look. You know, we got a bunch of grandkids. If you don't have any grandkids and you want to borrow some, we're working on number 20 right now. All you got to do is give me a call. I'll let you borrow some.
But I had one of them just barely walking, a little case, and he was in the backyard, and he is a pawpaw's boy, so everywhere I had to watch. I had to watch where I was stepping because I didn't want to step on him. And then, of course, we had Ariana. And all of you know that Ariana is Pablo's girl, so I had her all over the place. And I'm out there just playing with them kids, and we're getting dirty, and we're getting... And all of a sudden, it just hit me how good the Lord is that he's given me another day. And I picked up them kids, and I gave them a hug, and I gave them a kiss. I'm going to get choked up and start crying here in a second. And I just let them know how much Grandpa loved them. And then I put them down, and I watched them running and playing through that backyard, and I got to shouting, and I got to praising, and the Lord was thinking, boy, I know the Lord's touched that again. And my neighbor said, hey, that! It got my attention. I said, yeah. He said, are you all right over there? I said, yeah, don't mind me. I'm just praising the Lord. He just shook his head, walked on in the back of his house.
You can see the glory of God come down no matter where you're at. Here's the thing. You've got to be looking for the glory of God.
All we're paying attention to anymore is what's bad. All we're paying attention to is the bad news that's in our world today. And I'm going to touch on that here in just a minute. But if all you ever do is pay attention to that which is bad, you are never going to feel like having a heart worth of thanksgiving and praise. If you start to pay attention to the good things that God has put in your life, and you start being truly thankful for them to the point where you're willing to open your heart up and say thank you. And I'm not telling you all got to go in your backyard and shout and be. That's just what I did. But the Scripture teaches us that you can go into your closet and close the door and pray to your God in secret. And when you come out of that prayer closet, what you've done in secret, He'll bless you with openly by saying the glory of the Lord come down. Can I tell you something? There's also written in the Scripture a time when they were gathered together in the temple, and they all come together in one mind, and they all come together in one accord, and they begin to lift their voices, and they begin to give God perfect praise, and the glory of God fell in their congregation to the point where the priests could not minister anymore, where the singers could not sing anymore, where the prayers could not pray anymore. They were saturated with the glory of God, and all they could do was fall out and let the glory of God fall upon them. You don't have to be in church for that to happen.
Amen.
You can do that in your own home, in your own backyard. It doesn't take you being loud and vocal to the point where your neighbor says, hey, Dad. You can be just as quiet as a little church mouse.
But acknowledge God. Thank Him for what He's done. Praise Him for who He is.
Stop focusing on how hard life is. Stop focusing on how much sin there is in our world. Stop focusing on the bad. And start paying attention to the good, because you know what? The Bible teaches us that every good and every perfect gift comes from God above. If there's something good in your life, God did that. When you're able to say thank you, Lord, you'll see the glory come down. The old men wept, but the young men praised. But they had never seen the glory of God come down. Today, we who have been around a while and have seen, those of us who have been through revivals, how many of you remember that giant revival from back in the late 70s? When people were coming to Jesus Christ and repenting of their sins, and the church was exploding in growth. And it wasn't because they were preaching some damnable doctrine. They were declaring the gospel of Jesus Christ, and people were humbling themselves under the mighty hand of God and coming to Jesus Christ and receiving salvation. And I remember the church just exploding in growth. And it wasn't a false growth. It was true. It was real. And we've seen those revivals. How many of you remember old camp meetings? Oh, I might be telling myself, but down home, they all look. We had revivals, we also had camp meetings. And I just loved the old camp meetings. And preachers would come and they would preach. And they would call sin, sin. And they would call righteousness, righteousness. They would tell you that heaven is sweet and hell is hot. And the only way to escape a hot hell is through a loving Jesus. Oh my goodness, you'd walk away from there feeling
brand new person. That's because you became a brand new person.
Yes, yes.
We've seen revivals. We've seen them old camp meetings. We've seen them old preachers that have walked with God. You know, there's a preacher that I know of. Well, bless his heart, he's gone on home to be with the Lord. But how many of you ever heard of a place called Tip Top, Kentucky? I know there's some Kentucky folks here. Have you ever heard of Tip Top? There's a little old regular Baptist church in Tip Top, Kentucky. And it was pastored by a man who really, really, really had my respect. He could not read a word. I used to think, how in the world is he preaching the Bible? He can't read. That was before I knew the Lord. Now I know the Spirit of the Lord living and dwelling on the inside of a person. If he calls you, he'll use you, and he'll give you the ability to do what he's calling you to do. But back then, I hadn't accepted Jesus Christ. And I didn't understand. He would call upon somebody. He'd say, I need a reader for today. And somebody would raise their hand, and he'd bring them up in the pulpit, and he'd tell them, this is the verse of Scripture that I'm looking for, and they'd find it in the Bible. And he'd say, okay, go ahead and read, and they'd read a few verses, and he'd stop them, and he'd preach. When he would preach, it was powerful, and then he'd say, go ahead and read some more. You get the point. You see what I'm trying to teach you here? We've seen them old preachers that the reason they were able to do that is because they understood God. They understood the character of Jesus Christ. They knew that sin was always going to be sin, and if you cried out against sin, you were crying out for Jesus Christ. And they would preach till the glory of God would fall down in that church. We've seen them walk with the Lord. We've seen them. We've seen them old preachers. We can say that this ain't church anymore. We can say this ain't a revival anymore. There was a time when the church was praying for a revival. They were actually indicating that something in us has died and it needs to be revived. That's where you get the word revival. When Jesus spoke Lazarus' name, Lazarus revived. He came to life and he walked. When Jesus touched that widow's son that was being carried through the dusty streets on that bier, Jesus came by and had compassion on her and touched him, and he revived. He came back to life. The word revival doesn't mean that we're going to have a series of meetings for a week at 7 o'clock at the church, where we invite every singer that we can invite, we invite every preacher that we can have, and we shout and sing, we jump and we run the aisles. And a true revival is when the church comes together and something that has died gets filled with the Holy Ghost and comes back to life again. And lost people come to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and their Savior. That's revival. It's not just the fact that we meet together for 7 nights. These old Jews, by their weeping, were saying, this ain't Jerusalem anymore. How many of you remember in The Wizard of Oz, Dorothy saying, Odo, we ain't in Kansas anymore. These old men were saying, we ain't in Jerusalem. That got me thinking about that old movie, The Wizard of Oz. Dorothy needed to get to the Emerald City. Do you remember that? So she can find out how to get home. So she finds 3 characters. You've already identified the characters. These 3 characters, she found these 3 characters and she asked them to help her to get to the Emerald City. And I think you'll remember them. Our churches are not what they used to be because of character number 1, the 10 men. If you're taking notes, I apologize. I know right now you're thinking this is the craziest thing in the world. Pastor Thad is really going to preach to us about the Wizard of Oz. If you're taking notes, I promise I'm not going to be much longer. But you might want to write these down. Our churches and our homes and our communities and our nation, our world today is not what it used to be. Yeah. And the reason for it is because of the 10 men. How many of you know what the 10 man's problem was?
His joints were all rusty.
His joints were all rusty. Yep, that's part of it. See, the 10 man had a twofold problem. His joints were all rusty, and you've got the other one, is it?
Yeah.
He didn't have a heart. The 10 man was operating without a heart, and he hadn't had a heart for so long that he got rusty and needed oil. I'm going to talk to you about both of those. You know, whatever a person's treasure is, there will their heart be also. Is that not what the scripture teaches us? Wherever a man's treasure is, there will his heart be also. A man does what he does because his heart is attached to a certain thing. When I was lost and undone in my sin, my heart was attached to me and what I wanted, and shame on anybody else. My treasure was in me, and I was my own treasure. And if I wanted it, I did it. If I wanted to go, I went. If I wanted to say it, I said it. If I wanted to do it, I did it. And shame on anybody or anything that had to have anything to do with it. And when I got saved, I got changed. I became a new person in Christ. And now, if I want to say it, I'll say it. If I want to do it, I'll do it. If I want to go, I'll go. You say, what's the difference? The difference is I no longer want to say and do and go where I used to want to say and do and go. My heart has changed. My heart is no longer in that. My heart now is in Jesus Christ, not in my flesh. My heart now is with my home, not with my own extracurricular activities. My heart now is with my wife and with my children. And can I tell you, they're all a treasure to me. I think we need to change focus. Why in the world do I want to go to church today, preacher? It's going to be 81 degrees. I got to clean up my golf game a little bit. When I drove to church this morning, do you know how many people were already out on the golf course? I thought to myself, you know what? One of these days, we ought to just have us a field trip. I've preached from the back of my truck before. I can do it again. There's a little public place right there by the golf course. I know some of y'all are sweating right now saying, oh, please don't do that. Please don't do that. I won't do that to you. But wouldn't it be wonderful if someone did back their truck up into that public parking place and stand on the tailgate and declare the gospel of Jesus Christ and see them men and women looking around and say, what in the world are you doing? And give them the answer, if you're not coming to church, then the church is going to come to you. Swing your golf club and I'll get to the altar here in just a moment. Our treasure is wherever our heart is attached to. Can I ask you a question this morning? Do we have any 10 men or 10 women in the church? When I say 10, I don't mean 10. I mean 10, T-I-N. Although there was a time when I thought that's how you spell 10. Do we have a 10 man in our midst today? Are you going through life with no heart? Are we half-heartedly serving God? Are we half-heartedly serving Jesus Christ? Well, I think I do a pretty good job of serving the Lord. If you want to get a good picture of how well you're serving the Lord, take a look at how well you're serving your husband. Take a look at how well you're serving your wife. Take a look at how well you're serving your children. Take a look at how well you're serving others, because the scripture gives us a life principle. We serve the Lord by serving others. Jesus girded himself, filled a bowl full of water up, and washed the disciples' feet. He became a servant. Out of love and mercy and compassion, he became a servant. And we serve the Lord by serving others. The dead man didn't have a heart, and he was rusty, and he needed oil. Bless your heart. You understand in the scripture what oil represents? Oil represents the Holy Ghost. And it had been a long time that old
in his hand, ready to go to work, ready to do something, ready to make a difference, ready to make a change. But he stood there, and he stood there, and he stood there with his axe in his hand, never doing anything. And the rain fell, and the dew fell, and he got rusty. How many people do you know? Maybe it's you, maybe it's me. We're standing there with our axe in our hand, but we never swing it. We say, well, I'm going to get involved, but we never get involved. We say, I'm going to pray, but we never... How many of you are on Facebook? Go ahead, I'm on Facebook. You can raise your hand. I'll pray for the rest of you didn't, because most people are on Facebook. How many times do you see somebody post and say, pray for such and such or so and so? And how many times do you see people say, I'm praying? Are you really praying, or are you just typing? Oh, they've been on my friends list for a long time. I don't want them to think I'm just scrolling down past them. Okay, I'm praying. If you're going to type the words I'm praying and don't just stand there with your axe in your hand getting rusty, get down on your knees and pray. The old tin man standing there with his axe in his hand. And he got rusty. It's been a long, long time. And I got to tell you, I think it's been a long, long time in our church world since we have felt the oil, the Holy Spirit, hit our joints and begin to work us and begin to loosen us and begin to bring us back to life. He's standing up just saying, and he put some oil on his jaws where he could begin to move him. And when he began to move him, he wanted to say, he said, oh, Lord, look, he was shouting, listen to me, I think we've gotten off track. I think our church world today has been standing in one place, looking good with an axe in their hand, but never doing nothing with it. And we've gotten rusty, and we've gotten tight, and we've gotten seized up. And what we need to do is quit quenching the Holy Spirit of God and let the Holy Ghost fall and let the oil fall upon us and loosen our joints and get us back to movement again. Listen to me today, friend. Faith is an action word. It's not a verb. It's not a noun. It's a verb. And if we have faith, that means it's something that we do. But we quit doing it. We quit trusting. We quit praying. We quit looking. We're standing here with our axe in our hand. And we've gotten rusty. The tin man. We've lost our heart to serve the Lord. We've lost our love for the Word of God. Not only did he have no heart, but he got rusty and he needed the oil. We need a fresh oiling today. Our churches are not what they used to be. Our homes are no longer what they used to be. Our lives are no longer what they used to be. Because of too many tin men. Our church world today is not what it used to be because of the cowardly lion. Well, I'm going to go after this like a dog on a pork chop. Preachers today are scared to death to preach the truth of God's word. And because of it, our people today are scared to death to live a life that is based on God's word. I might offend somebody. Can I tell you? Jesus offended people when he was here.
Yes, he did.
He didn't do it out of hatefulness. He didn't do it out of anger. But he didn't care one iota about being politically correct. It was either right or it was wrong. If it was right, he called it right. If it was wrong, he called it wrong. And he called it like it was. He called it like it is. But today, we are so afraid of offending somebody. There's preachers who will congregations and in our communities. Afraid. Afraid. Oh, I love the Lord, but I don't want nobody to know. Can I tell you there ain't no such thing as secret Christianity?
Yeah.
You're either in Christ or you're not. You don't have to go around telling somebody you're a Christian. Your life ought to tell them. I think I said last week, there's so many people walking around handing out business cards saying, I'm a preacher. Handing out business cards saying, I'm a Christian. If you've got to hand out a business card to tell somebody you're a preacher, chances are you ain't very good. That lion was a coward. He was afraid. And too many people are afraid today. I wonder how many bakeries are afraid now of losing their business. I wonder how many flower shops today are afraid of losing their business. Preachers today are afraid of losing their churches. I'm just going to be honest with you and transparent. And I'm going to let you know. If that ever comes this way, get ready to have church down at the county jail. Because I'll get locked up before I say yes to that. Ain't home as long as I'm going home. What's right is right, what's wrong is wrong. Do I operate in love? Yes. Do I operate in compassion? Yes. Will I befriend them? Yes. I might even go out to dinner. We can fellowship. We can laugh. You come to my house, we'll have some sweet tea and sit in the backyard. You can watch my little grandchildren run through my backyard and hear me praise the Lord. I'm not going to separate that. I'm not going to shove you aside because you don't do what I do. Shove you aside because you don't believe what I believe. But if you think I'm going to stand in this pulpit and bring them two together as, I don't even know what you call it, wife and wife or husband and husband, you better get ready to have church down at the county jail, because I'm going to jail before I do that. Listen, we have no room for cowardice. We need to stand upon the Word of God, and what's right is right, and what's wrong is wrong, what's truth is truth, and what's lie is lie. We have no cowardice. That lion lacked cowardice, lacked courage. They're afraid of losing money. They're afraid of losing people. They're afraid to preach the truth. They're afraid to call sin sin. They're afraid to preach heaven sweet and hell hot and declare the truth that Jesus Christ is the only way. We need to get these cowards out of the pulpit and put some real men in, and let the lost be saved and let the church be strengthened. Churches ain't what they used to be because of character number three. We've covered the 10 men. We've covered the cowardly lion. Who's the third? The scarecrow. Boy, do I have something. What was the scarecrow's problem? He didn't have a brain. I want to drop the reins on this horse and let it run. I'll be nice. We remember him. He didn't have no brains. And what was he afraid of?
Fire.
Fire. You know what? Fire and oil both represent the Holy Spirit in the Scripture. And we've gotten afraid of the Holy Spirit. We've gotten afraid of the Holy Ghost. I'm not ashamed to tell people I'm a Baptist minister, but you know how many of my Baptist brethren get mad at me because I preach about the Holy Ghost? That's just not something we know. I said, then you need to get saved.
Yeah.
Because without the Holy Ghost,
yeah.
Without the Spirit, you're none of His.
Yes.
That's what the Scripture says. It goes together. It's not just about the blood. It's also about the infilling of the Holy Spirit. That's where you get your power. What's the Bible say? Greater is He that is in you. Picture the Holy Ghost. We're afraid of the Holy Ghost. We're afraid. That's another message for another day. The scarecrow had no brains.
20-some years ago, our churches got together and decided we need to look and feel more like this world and take a look at what has happened to our church world. I think that was a foolish decision. I think it was absolutely crazy. I think they had no brains. Yeah. They wanted to look more like the world and feel more like the world and act more like the world in order to draw the world. And it was absolutely ludicrous. Look what has happened. All we have produced is religious people. We have not produced a whole lot of saved people. We've replaced the Bible with poems. We've replaced the Bible with intellectual nonsense that has been pulled down off of the internet and copied off and handed out to our members so that they can follow along. Those that do not use Scripture, put it on overhead so that you don't have to be burdened with carrying your Bible to church. Can I say something? If you're not reading your Bible in church, don't try to fool me into thinking you're reading the Bible at home. We're not scarecrows. We got brains. I said, how many of you are getting so tired of hearing about the bathroom law? I'm getting tired of hearing about the bathroom law. I'm getting so tired of hearing about the bathroom law. That is just, to me, that is elementary. If you're a guy and you want to dress up like a girl, hey, have at it. But if you got to use the bathroom, stay out of the bathroom where my little daughter and my little granddaughter are going to the bathroom. Amen. You don't have to be a rocket scientist to figure that one out. You don't have to be a politician. Actually, there's not a politician in this world that's going to figure that out because we revert back to the cowardly lion. Yeah. None of them want to say, this is the craziest thing I've ever heard of, and we got big problems going on in our nation, and we're not going to spend 5 more minutes talking about the bathroom law. You see what I'm saying? I'm not preaching for it. I'm not preaching against it. I'm trying to show how absolutely brainless that is. We focus on those things when we need to be focusing on solid things. The scarecrow didn't have no brains. And sometimes I think our nation and our world, our communities, we're operating without a brain. We don't stop to think. We don't apply the intellect that God has given us to the word that God has given us. What is it that God is really wanting us to focus on? What is it that God is really wanting us to do? We've replaced the Bible with poems and intellectual nonsense. We've replaced the hymn books with praise choruses. We've stifled the Holy Ghost and lean more toward entertainment. Can I tell you there's hope? Can I tell you there is hope? Sometimes it just seems like it's all a bad dream, doesn't it? Sometimes you just sit there and you think, this can't be real. This is just a bad dream. Can I tell you there's hope? There is hope. Dorothy woke up, didn't she? When she woke up, she saw those that are around her that love her and care for her. Yam, Uncle Henry, was that his name? That traveling medicine guy. The farmhands. Toto was there. And she was trying her best to explain to everybody what she had seen, where she'd been, and they were all like, okay, Dorothy, you just got hit over the head a little bit hard. You know, I think we've just been hit over the head a little bit too hard. And I don't mean that condescendingly. I mean we've been broadsided. I mean we've been distracted. Brother Darrell spends a lot of time talking about distractions. We've been distracted. Our eyes have been turned off of the message and onto the mess. And really what we need to do is turn our eyes off of the mess and back on the message. And know that Jesus Christ is still the King of Kings. Know that He's still the Lord of Lords. And know that there's nothing that happens in this world that He's not aware of. And He's got a plan. He's got a purpose for each and every one. Amen. Amen? Amen. There's always hope in Jesus Christ. Dorothy wound back up at home. Friend, don't lose focus. Don't lose faith. We're on a journey, and we're going to make it home. We may have to walk through ugly stuff to get there. There may be valleys. There may be valleys to cross. There may be rivers to swim. Amen. We may get our feet a little wet. We may get our feet a little muddy. But Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Our hearts might get broken, but joy cometh in the morning. Amen. Don't pay attention to the mess. Pay attention to the message. And know that there's always hope in Jesus Christ. I feel like I've preached my message. Let's rise to our feet.